critical development point. Born to mothers with poor nutrition or malnourished mothers are more likely to become ill, which is going to add a lot of stress to the families, and obviously add a lot of stress to the infant, and add a lot of health care costs to that. They're more likely to have birth defects. They're more likely to have retarded mental and retarded physical development. So the time to start right is early on. Risk factors, who's most likely to be malnourished in the mother category, which would give that baby a risk factor for being low birth weight. Low birth weight babies are babies that weigh less than one. Five and a half pounds. With low birth weight babies, babies weighing less than 5.5 pounds, have much more difficulty with illnesses, much more difficulty potentially with physical and mental retardation. So keeping or reducing the number of low birth weight babies born in this country can greatly affect our society, can greatly affect our healthcare dollars, can greatly affect families and their support. So women that we can be concerned about when they're pregnant are those that are, first of all, less than 15 years of age. Teen mothers have a much increased risk to low birth weight babies. Some of that is related to their nutritional status. Women with unwanted pregnancies. So I wasn't trying to get pregnant, didn't know I was going to get pregnant, didn't really want to get pregnant. Those women are at increased risk for having low birth weight babies. Women who have frequent pregnancies. Who doesn't know somebody that hasn't had 5 kids in 5 years or something? That has kids every 9, 10, 12, 14 months? Uh-huh. With each subsequent pregnancy, because the mother's nutritional status has not had time to go kind of back up to normal prior to being pregnant again, there is increased risk for low birth weight babies. So their nutritional status would be increased risk. Women with a history of poor outcome, meaning they've had a low birth weight baby before, or maybe they've had a miscarriage, or maybe they've had a stillborn, with some kind of poor outcome to a previous pregnancy. They are going to be at increased risk for having low birth weight babies. Women who live in poverty, obviously if you only have X number of dollars, you have to prioritize, and food isn't always high on the priority list, or adequate nutrition is not high on the priority list. Women who continue strict dieting practices during pregnancy are going to be increased risk for low birth weight babies. We're going to talk about weight gain recommendations and why those are there. People who are gaining weight when they're pregnant are going to be at risk for having low birth weight babies. And so many women diet during the pregnancy and restrict calories and nutrients because they're too scared of gaining a number of pounds. Women who smoke are at increased risk for low birth weight babies, and that's more related to adequate oxygen and growth potential. Also, people who smoke tend not to eat as much, be thinner in general. Women who use or abuse drugs during pregnancy are at high risk for low birth weight babies. Alcohol abuse. Women who use alcohol are at higher risk. Women who have a chronic disease are at higher risk. So maybe they have diabetes. Maybe they have fibrosis, some kind of chronic disease that they have themselves. And women that are less than 85 are increased risk for low birth weight babies. So these factors at the start of pregnancy or during pregnancy can greatly affect the outcome of that pregnancy, and many of these are really nutrition related. So when we start talking about what is optimal nutrition during pregnancy, that in the end should help decrease our incidence of low birth weight babies. So again, low birth weight babies want less than 500, 5.5 pounds. How long are women pregnant? What's the normal gestation period? Huh? 9 months, exactly. 40 weeks, and they actually divide the week into trimesters. So when we talk about weight gain and nutritional requirements, oftentimes we're talking about it in trimesters. First trimester is the zero, like say it's induction movement, 13. And then the second, and the 14 weeks, we put it fifth. And the third trimester is 27. Stages of critical development, you're talking about it in the concept of trimester. This is what happens in the first trimester, this is what happens in the second trimester, this is what happens in the third trimester. How much weight should be gained during the pregnancy? And these numbers will be for the entire pregnancy. And this is really based upon how much pre-pregnant weight is there. So a person who is of normal weight, which is typically what we're going to see with charts as far as weight gain recommendations, the recommended weight gain is 25 to 35 pounds. A woman who is underweight prior to pregnancy, the recommendation for weight gain during pregnancy is higher than that, 28 to 40 pounds. On the other hand, a woman who is obese or overweight prior to pregnancy, the recommendations are a little bit lower, but still, it doesn't say 8 pounds, it doesn't say 5 pounds, it's 16 to 25 pounds. And then I put there with twins because I think that that's interesting that you don't double the recommended amount of weight gain just to have a second baby. It's 35 to 40 pounds. So it's not, it doesn't get incremented the same amount with each fetus. So where does this weight come from? If you think most infants are somewhere between 6.5 and 8 pounds. There are lots of different gains. And this is what the mother needs to realize, is that just because she's gaining 25 pounds or 35 pounds and the baby only weighs 6 pounds, but this other weight is very important and is related to the pregnancy itself. Now this is actually in your book, table 10-3. Page 37. So you don't have to write it down on the book. It's in your book. So if in a birth, this particular chart uses 7 to 8 pounds, the placenta, does anybody know what the placenta is? Is it 1 pound? It's the way that nutrients and waste products get passed back and forth between the mother and the infant. To increase the mother's blood volume to supply the placenta. So you need more blood when you're pregnant. You have more circulation space. That's going to account for 4 pounds. That blood volume is going to go down after you deliver. Okay, but there is weight related to that. It increases the mother's fluid volume. It's another 4 pounds. Again, as blood volume increases, so does overall fluid volume. And you'll see many women with swollen feet and ankles and those types of things. But hanging on to excess fluid is just a normal part of the pregnancy process. So there's 4 pounds. That fluid goes away. One of the most surprising things to me, though, is it didn't go away the next day. For some reason, I thought I had a baby. The next day, I wake up and I look at my feet and they'd be normal. And it didn't happen. It took like probably 3 or 4 weeks before my feet were back to normal. So they don't lose all this weight immediately after they deliver. But for some reason, I just expect my feet to be back normal. You also have a weight related to the increase in size of the uterus and the muscles to support it, and that could be 2 pounds. Think about somebody who starts a weight training program, and they start lifting weights, right? Those muscles get bigger because they're put under more stress. Okay? You start to weigh more on a scale. People who build muscle mass start to increase weight oftentimes. During this time, especially when you're holding a fetus in your uterus, you're exercising those muscles. You're building them up. When that weight is no longer there, that fetus is no longer there and you deliver, just like if you stop lifting weights after lifting them for a period of time, those muscles are going to go back down and they're going to atrophy, so they're not going to weigh as much. So there's just a change in body musculature as well because you've got the extra weight of the fetus. So there's another couple pounds. Increase in size of the mother's breast is another couple pounds. You get more swelling, more fluid, more other issues on the way there. Some women love that, some women don't. So you have to kind of play that whichever way it goes. The amniotic fluid that surrounds the infant to protect it is a source of weight, and that's another couple pounds, and that is also related to then the stress on the muscles supporting the uterus. And then really here's where the difference is. The mother's fat stores. Okay, we actually should put away some fat stores during our pregnancy in preparation for lactation or breastfeeding. And even if you know that you're not going to breastfeed, your body automatically starts storing things away in preparation for that. So there's where you get the biggest variance. And that's where a person who is overweight can watch this. But there's still, say, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, about 22 pounds or so of weight related to pregnancy, weight that will go away after delivery. Okay? So you see how these are really necessary to having a healthy baby and how they'll all go away when you don't need the extra blood volume, you don't have that extra fluid, how you can deliver that baby. So you really, people that are freak out about it, or people like, you're going to be one of those women that are freaked out about the extra weight related to pregnancy, realizing a lot of that is normal, natural, you know, it's not saying you have gained 50 pounds, but it's saying that within this reasonable amount of weight gain, there's really a central weight gain that's there. And denying yourself of that, and there are people who go through pregnancy that don't gain weight, they still have these increases here, but they've lost their own body stores. Okay, so they're putting themselves at risk for inadequate nutrition. Okay, so that's how much you should gain during the whole pregnancy. Now, the rate of pregnancy is also important. Really, during this 0 to 13 weeks, the first trimester, that baby is so little, the amount, there's the muscle mass there, you are starting to build your blood supply, but essentially, not gain any weight during the first 3 months. The first 6 weeks you get, most women don't even know that they're pregnant. You know, and then for some reason people say, pregnant, you know, I have to start gaining weight. But really that first trimester, the recommendation is small to maybe 2 to 3 pounds during that whole first 3 month time span of pregnancy. Then after that, the average is approximately a pound per week. And, you know, obviously there'll be some weeks where a person's weight doesn't change, other weeks it may go up a couple of pounds. But then the average weight gain from week 40 to 14 would be about a pound per week during the second and third trimester. One of the other points is that dads don't necessarily have to gain on the weight. They don't have to gain the weight along with the mother. You'll see a lot of whole families gain 25 pounds during pregnancy. So work with that. That's not a so this pica, has anybody heard of pica? Pica is an odd craving for non-food items. Some people in the party who've all heard of food cravings, well, some people crave non-food items, things like dirt, things like clay, things like laundry starch. It's actually pretty common. It's really common, but it is. There are people that aren't pregnant that have pica as well, but pica is more prevalent during pregnancy. In some cultures, it's more prevalent than kind of in Midwest, Missouri, but there are women that are being treated and counseled for pica. The problem with that is if you identify a woman who has pica, obviously doesn't have malnutrition, because if they're eating dirt and clay and laundry starch instead of food, that's going to be, you know, a concern for the nutritional status. Also, excess weight gain, because laundry starch, you know, extra laundry starch is one of the most common things, has calories. You know, it has, your body will digest it, and it is starch, so you will have calories there. They could have, ingestion of toxic substances. There's no reason to say somebody's going to crave something that won't be toxic to them, or they won't consume something that won't be toxic to them, or they won't cause an intestinal obstruction. The African American culture actually is pica tends to run in family, and it's almost a social substance. Well, my mom does it, and I do it, and then I have three or four friends that also do things. It can be very soon. People don't even necessarily realize that it's a bad thing, because the cravings are there with a strong desire.
What is it, physical or not?
A little bit of both. And it's just more likely to show itself during times of pregnancy. Another concern is fetal alcohol syndrome. Everybody heard of fetal alcohol syndrome? Irreversible brain damage can cause physical and mental retardation. The effect on the fetus is, again, most prevalent in that first trimester, before women even know that they're pregnant. So the recommendation for alcohol use is really to abstain from alcohol as soon as somebody even thinks about getting pregnant. Now, obviously, there are people that are trying to get pregnant, and have it abstain from alcohol. And then what happens is somebody's planning a pregnancy, they probably should stop drinking alcohol as soon as pregnancy is desired. There's a picture of the facial traits of a child born with fetal alcohol syndrome on page 371 in your book. They tend not to have much of a nose bridge or flat. Nasal bridge, short eyelid opening, small head, underdeveloped bruise here in your lip area. And those are typical outward signs that you can see. But babies born with fetal alcohol syndrome can have devastating mental and physical retardation. Some of them obviously aren't as devastating as this, maybe a little delayed, a little slow. Dieting being one of those concerns for having a baby of low birth weight. Dieting is a concern, even especially right now, these high protein, low carbohydrate diets promote ketosis and promote the burning of body fat for our calories, and your brain can't live on ketone bodies alone and use some glucose, so especially those low carbohydrate, high protein diets are especially dangerous during pregnancy and don't provide the baby with adequate nutrition. Talked about smoking. Smoking is going to decrease the blood supply coffee, and how much coffee can I take in, and how am I going to live without my coffee or my soda or whatever the case may be. The recommendation for caffeine use during pregnancy is that they have moderate use of both. High or heavy use of caffeine is associated with low birth weight. The moderation is key. You do not have to cut out all the caffeine in your diet when you're pregnant. Typically, moderation is considered like one cup of coffee or the caffeine in two sodas a day. The chart on page 374 actually gives you the caffeine content of different beverages. So moderation is approximately 100 milligrams per day. So you can take a look at their chart and rather than caffeine and chocolate or something else, and you can use that to get to about 100 milligrams. Less than 100 milligrams a day, or right around 100 milligrams a day, is considered moderate and appropriate. What about NutraSweet? Remember, NutraSweet is one of the artificial sweeteners. A lot of people here are concerned about using NutraSweet when they're pregnant. They are two proteins put together, just like the proteins we eat in other foods, so there is no contraindication to the use of NutraSweet during pregnancy. How many people know somebody who won't be able to take the kind of thing to get out of the kind of baby? And if that's your first appointment, you don't have to use an artificial sweetener or nutrition sweetener in your pregnant, but they've done tons and tons of studies and there have been no detrimental effects to my use of the artificial sweetener immediately in pregnancy. So that is not a, not really a concern. So it's a concern of women, but it's not going to show that pregnancy outcome. Other concerns that you hear pregnant women, we can think of the pregnant women that have related to things. We're going to talk on next Wednesday actually about specific nutrients, calories, protein, vitamins, minerals, and those types of things related to pregnancy and related to lactation. And some of the common problems are that we can talk about morning sickness, we can talk about the physical diabetes, resistant development that we use during pregnancy, and we're going to do those types of topics on next Wednesday. So what do I want to talk about? Now actually, infant nutrition. Okay. This is infant nutrition. Time to get through all of the research today. I didn't want to do part of them today and part of next Wednesday. I'm just going to save all those for the next one. Infant nutrition is actually one of the most important topics. Nutrition is more important during the first year of life than any other time. So luckily, it doesn't take a lot of thought. It's pretty easy. Why is nutrition important during pregnancy? Or during infancy? Is because it's the fastest time of growth. If you think about it, birth weight doubles between 4 and 6 months. So if you have a baby that's 7 pounds when it's born, it's 14 pounds before the time it's 6 months old. Do we ever want to double our weight any other time?
No.
Definitely. So it's the fastest time of growth, and birth weight triples by 1 year. So again, a 7-pound baby born is 21 pounds in a year, approximately. So it can double within the first 6 months and then triple prior or around the first year. Infant feeding is easy because essentially the only appropriate issues are breastfeeding or infant formula, initially. So I'm going to start with breastfeeding. I want to work our way through. Not actually contains antibodies and a lot of the immunity factors, it provides something called the diffidence factor. The diffidence factor promotes healthy bacterial growth in the infant's GI tract, so there are less GI intolerances. It contains diffidence factor.
And so that helps?
If that helps promote the growth of healthy bacteria, of friendly bacteria in the GI system, which can then minimize GI intolerances. Your GI tract, especially colon, is supposed to have bacteria in it, and it's a very important part of keeping it healthy. So breast milk ends up being the perfect food. Factors in human health to promote infant health are antibodies, the bacterial factors we talked about, lactoferrin, which is an antibacterial. There are enzymes and hormones that help promote the health of your infant, and it ends up being that perfect food. It really is the best makeup for infant digestion, for infant absorption, for any micronutrient, vitamin, mineral needs. Breastfed infants have lower rates of illnesses, lower rates of being admitted to the hospital, lower rates of ear infections, lower rates of allergies. Breast milk is actually especially important for that premature infant who hasn't been able to develop appropriately.
I'm curious, why do they, if you have a premature, and they generally don't allow you to nurse the premature in the hospital, what are they thinking of?
Oftentimes what they do is they pump and give them, mm-hmm. and they give them, and they may have to put it down the tube even because the premature infant may not be able to suckle, even may not be strong enough to extract it from the breast. So they, I mean, I know I have a sister-in-law that had a premature baby, and she pumped,
and they
fed the baby that milk. Mm-hmm.
Okay, because I was in the impression that they weren't
in the very critically ill, they may not, because they may not even be able to tolerate anything GI-wise, and then they just store it and reuse it as appropriately. But to start the whole lactation mechanism in the mother is very important. Yeah, oftentimes they just use it, but the baby's not strong enough to actually latch on, or too sick to have a good eating mechanism, so you just make it easier for them. And actually provide it to them as opposed to making it more for receiving. Yeah, exactly. The problem is that despite all these benefits of breastfeeding, you know, all the bonding and all the emotional benefits, the incidence of breastfeeding has actually decreased in the United States. And why do you think that is?
They don't want to bother with their trouble, because a lot of people, a lot of women are now in the workforce, mm-hmm. and in other things, and, you know, just to see them, it's easier to have some bother
with them. See, I thought it had really gone up.
Yeah, overall, the percentages are down, but they're coming, like, back up, but from X number of years ago to now, they're still down. The decline was more, and it is starting to move forward a little bit. But, you know, it's the most natural, it has all these benefits. There's just big concerns about people and breastfeeding. Any amount of breastfeeding, and I think this is what kills a lot of, or what stops a lot of people, is they think they have to do it forever. Any time breastfeeding is a huge benefit for that infant. So if that time is only 2 weeks, or 4 weeks, or 6 weeks, or 3 months, it's not that you're supposed to, you have to have an 18-month-old attached to you. You can, you know, wean as necessary. So any time that you see that, only into about 2 weeks, you can make that decision for you to nurse for any of the short period of time. That is really a huge benefit for the baby. It's also a benefit to the mother, because we'll see, you know, next Wednesday when we talk about calorie needs, you actually need more calories during lactation, and it's a wonderful time. You can actually lose weight in your extra time, calorie having adequate. And it helps you, that's what those vegetables will put there to begin with, to provide those extra calories for lactation. So it has benefits to the mother as well. So again, any time, pregnancy is better than no time, and that's it all. Anybody ever heard of the Lychee Ling? So the Lychee League is a nonprofit organization made up of women who strongly believe in breastfeeding, who have lots of support for you. We have counselors that come to your house. We will send you information. We will answer your questions. We will be available 24 hours a day for the middle of the night when you're crying because you're not sure what's going on and why you can't get your baby to nurse. They are the community support group for that. Find a number in the Yellow Pages, and if anybody considers breastfeeding, or you're talking to your sister, or aunt, or whoever, and they have concerns or need support, and that's probably the biggest thing with that is once the person has made the decision to breastfeed, it's the adequate support to troubleshoot a lot of things. So people don't want to bother their doctor, and the doctor says, no, or they don't feel like they can ask that, but the relationship is just people like you and me, and so very strongly about breastfeeding and their children, and have become educated on the problems, the issues, the concerns, women like that. So find a number of the old babies and use that as a great resource. That's really what they're there for, just to promote that. Who cannot breastfeed? I'm going on about how good breastfeeding is, how everybody should breastfeed. But there are a few groups of people who you do not and cannot breastfeed.
Men can't.
Women with a communicable disease. You obviously don't want to infect the baby with a disease. So anybody with a particular disease is something that have a good chance of breastfeeding. AIDS. The AIDS virus is spread and it's not in breast milk, so if you're HIV positive or have AIDS, you're not breastfeed. If you have active TB, you're not breastfeed. And that actually is becoming more popular, unfortunately. The spread of TB is coming back. And hepatitis, which is an inflammation or an infection of your liver.
The AIDS virus is within the mother's milk.
It is just out. So you can't breastfeed if you have a baby.
What's the deal with the TV? Why is that coming back?
It's just one of those things called diseases. Typically, it's an airborne thing, breathing the air, but people with TV is one of the diseases that cannot have TV. Hepatitis, TV, and diabetes. You can do it with diabetes, you can do it with arthritis, you can do it with, chronic diseases, but not with TV.
You're saying that one of the reasons why TB and hepatitis is coming back is the lack of proper or overuse of medication? Antibiotics?
Not for these two particular ones. Whatever resistant strains to things is related to that, but not particularly TB and hepatitis. Some people are medication because those medications treated in breast milk for particular conditions cannot. So if somebody's on regular types of medications for a psychiatric disorder or some kind of chronic disease, you have to check those medications, use your physician to make sure that they don't pass and be less mild and a concern. So, because those are very varied medications, have to do that on an individual basis. And then women who are alcohol and drug addicts, we would not switch to them. Or they really can't break through because those substances will also pass to the baby, the other breast milk. So you don't need to have infant drug and alcohol addiction babies. There's enough problems with women using drugs and alcohol while they're pregnant and then the baby being born alcohol and drug dependent. But other than that, there really was no reason, nothing to do with size or age or anything like that. Infant formula is the other option. In the infant formula, the nutrient composition of breast milk is duplicated to the best of their ability. What is not there is the immunological factors. You don't have the different factors. You don't have the hormones. You don't have the enzymes. You don't have the antibodies. So, that the breast-fed people or infants are less ill, have less allergies, and have less risk of formula-fed babies, and that's because of the immunological factors that are present in breast milk that are not present in formula, nor will fed babies. The nutrient composition, though, is duplicated to the best of the abilities that we have. The other thing that many people feel that there is an advantage to formula feeding versus nursing is they can tell how much the baby eats. And there's any reason to know exactly how much your baby is taking in each and every time. Probably not. But people feel better or feel more confident to know, well, they were able to eat 4 ounces or 6 ounces or 8 ounces, where obviously the nursing, there's not that volume control that you had anything to do with. And some people sometimes that's the reason why they don't want to go is related to that. You know how much you're getting, so how do you know if you're getting enough? Well, essentially, you know, if you're saying weight gain. So if you're gaining the appropriate amount of weight and having appropriate amounts of, you know, loose diapers that are soiled, then they're getting nice and efficient. And some women just can't really grasp that or care to grasp that, and they really want to know who's off weight. How much should they be taking in or not taking in? And then the other advantage to infant feeding is they go through that then family members can help. And so the mother then is the sole keeper, the sole provider for that infant, but then anybody can put a formula, can put down a formula on the baby now. Because technically you could pump and anybody could feed the baby in that respect too, but it's a breast milk, so that's it. Going back. One of the biggest things to remember, no matter what a woman chooses, breast milk or formula, is that should be the beverage of choice for a year period. You continue to use breast milk or formula for the first year. After that, cow's milk can be introduced. But there is a concern about using cow's milk prior to that year time scale. Cow's milk nutrient composition and breast milk and formula nutrient composition are totally different. There's a lot more protein in cow's milk, which is very damaging to the kidneys of infants because they can't handle the load of the protein. There's a lot more sodium in cow's milk. There's not as much iron in cow's milk. So really, it's very important, even though you probably go, I put you on cow's milk for 3 months or 4 months or whatnot, that really is not for the advantage of the infant at all. And cow's milk is not being used until about that 1 year time frame for that. So breast milk and formula for the first year. Obviously, we're going to start using some solid foods, and so we need to look at signs of readiness for solid foods. Well, the first thing your mom is going to do is they're going to start feeding it, right? Cereal, birds, you name it, anything. how do you know when your baby is ready for solids? Well, typically, when they double their birth weight, which we say that they do between 4 and 6 months of age, remember they double between 4 and 6, they triple it a year. So typically at a double birth weight time, this is an indicator, at least by 6 months of age, if a mother has not started adding solid foods when the baby is 6 months old, it's time to do that. You can probably wait till about 6 months of age, but you don't necessarily want to go longer than that. And if you're able to sit upright with support and control of your head movement. And we all know the initial beauty test was really heavy and you don't have any muscles and they tend to flop all around. Well, because they don't have head movement, they also don't have the tongue control and all those other things, and they're getting pretty good for choking. What it won't do, feeding baby solid foods before they're ready and not helping to do the magnetic. I just want to get some cereal into them because it will stick in their stomach and then they'll flip water. You know that point? And I've got to get these kids to flip through the nuts. They want to start solid foods. There's been no studies that have really shown that giving them solid foods prior to sleeping much is longer at all. So they're really not to get. Other concerns are choking foods. What should you be eating? What are some common choking foods?
Hot dogs.
Hot dogs? No big ones? Anything else? Any good foods? Google foods? Great. Or a big one? Nuts? Choking foods and making sure that the child that you're feeding the infant toddler is something to be careful of. No honey for at least a year of age. You don't want to use honey in the feeder, and that's because the botulism spores of botulism, which is a huge poisoning, which we'll talk about food safety, can live in honey. And an infant's GI tract is not acidic enough to kill it. So where honey is not a food safety risk for an adult because the acidity of our GI tract would kill any botulism from honey, preventatory system, the infant's GI tract is not acidic enough and will not actually give botulism. And then a very common food allergy is egg white protein. So we also limit, for that first year, egg white protein. And yolk protein in that last 10 months or so on is fine, but not egg white protein. People that are allergic to eggs, I'm not saying you know people are allergic to eggs, but people who are allergic to eggs are allergic to the egg white protein. One of the most common allergies. Let's look at,10-5 in your book, and it talks a little bit about the first food for the infant. Page 380. And so initially, at that 4 to 6 month time frame, when the birth weight is doubled, when they have head control movement, you're going to first add iron-fortified rice cereal. Rice is the least likely of foods that people are allergic to. There are few people allergic to rice in this world than any other substance. So rice is the safest food. After rice has been introduced, then the other grains can be introduced. Then vegetables prior to fruit. Why do we want to give vegetables first?
Some of the food. And I don't want to go back to that if they get meat things first.
They get what kind of things first?
Meat. And things that are tasty for them.
Fruit. Or fruit, yeah. So technically at that 4 to 6, you know, about the 6 month age, fruits and vegetables are appropriate to add, but there is a ingrown preference to sweet things. So the recommendation is to provide vegetables first to get them exposed to a variety of those prior to adding the fruit, so that there should be an overall better acceptance of vegetables. So digestive-wise and swallowing-wise and those kinds of things, fruits or vegetables are appropriate, but vegetables for preference purposes are recommended first. 6 to 8 months starts, if they can sit upright more and you want to pour more crackers and bread things and biscuits for them. 8 to 10 months is when they start adding some of the protein foods, the cheeses, the yogurt, cooked beans, chopped beans, egg yolks. And then at that year point then, the whole egg, because egg allergies are less likely for that egg white protein, and then whole milk is the first milk product. So it should be breast milk or formula for the first year, whole milk from year 1 to 2, and then after age 2, a lower fat milk can be used if the diet. But they really should, when you do go to cow's milk, stay with whole milk for year 1 to 2, because they still need the fat for brain development. Last thing we're talking about, that's like iron deficiency anemia and food allergies, which are two nutrition-related problems. Iron deficiency anemia occurs because of the low iron content of cow's milk. So at that year point, and milk in a one-year-old diet is still a big part of the diet, so they don't get a lot of other iron sources. So infants actually are screened at 18 months for iron deficiency anemia. And there's a relatively large portion of the infants that have difficulties with that. And again, if you want to milk, you can make 4 tons of iron. Food allergies can be an issue, especially if you have a family history of food allergies. If you have several people in your family that have allergies, your children are more at risk. We talked about rice cereal being the safest food for avoiding food allergies, so that's the food that we do first. Oftentimes it takes several days of ingesting a food before you see any symptoms or signs of an allergy. So that's why we talk about when you introduce food, you give the same thing, you introduce one food at a time and you give it for 3 to 5 days prior to giving another new food. And that again is to screen for appropriate allergies. Signs of a food allergy could be a rash, could be GI discomfort, nausea, vomiting, gas, diarrhea, some of those issues, or even respiratory discomfort. So take it slow, know if you have a family history, avoid foods that people in your family are allergic to, and introduce foods one at a time, so if your infant does start to have a problem, you can relate it to people who go through. Have a wonderful Easter. Wednesday, when we come back, we'll finish pregnancy, mostly pregnancy and lactation, nutrient requirements, and complications of pregnancy.
I think you should be able to get this, you know, overall just. But when I start getting that, I don't know. I've just been getting them lately. I they've stopped, and now I've had two in the last 2 weeks, or last week. But it just wreaks havoc with your vision.